Good morning, all. Welcome back to Analysis of Indeterminate Structures. In this session, let us solve a simple pin-jointed truss by using flexibility matrix method. In previous sessions, we have analyzed continuous beams and portal frames, and we have used conjugate beam method and unit load method to get the unknown redundant forces. But now, to analyze this particular truss, here we are going to use method of joints. Here also, for better understanding, the entire solution for this particular problem has been divided into simple steps. As usual, we start with step number 1, and here also in step number 1 we are going to find out the degree of static indeterminacy, and the formula for this is given by Km plus R minus Nj. For trusses, K can be taken as 1, therefore it is M plus R, and N can be taken as 2. Therefore, to find the static indeterminacy in case of pin jointed trusses, we use M plus R minus 2J. Therefore, you count the number of members here. We have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and 6. 6 members, and number of reactions. We have 2 supports here, support A and support B. Support A is hinged and support B is roller. Therefore, at A we have 2 reactions and at B we have 1 reaction. Therefore, the total number of reactions are 3 minus 2 into number of joints. We have 1, 2, 3 and 4 joints. This is not a joint. Therefore, if you solve this particular equation, you are going to get 6 plus 3 is 9, 9 minus 8 it is 1. Therefore, the given structure is indeterminate to degree 1. Based on degree of static indeterminacy, we can assume the redundance. Since we have got only 1 degree of static indeterminacy, the size of matrix is 1 cross 1 here, plus DL, F and P matrices are all of size 1 cross 1. And you can assume any of the member as redundant here, or the reaction also. So to simplify the solution, always if you have a choice of assuming redundant, you can assume the diagonal elements as redundants. If they mention in the question particularly, like take BD as redundant or reaction at A as redundant or reaction at B as redundant, we don't have option. We have to assume that particular force as redundant. But when we have choice, preferably if you have diagonal elements, assume the diagonal elements as redundants. So here I can assume either AD or BC as redundant, any one diagonal element as redundant. So here I am going to take member force in AD as redundant, that is FAD as redundant. So, and you can call this as P also, that is P equals to FAD. So this completes step number 1, that is finding degree of static indeterminacy and assuming the suitable member force as redundant. Now in step number 2, we are going to calculate the forces in all the members because of the applied loading. You can call it as member forces. Due to applied external load. So just rewrite the diagram of truss, but here you have to remove the redundant. That means you need not to take the member AD, because AD is taken as redundant. You have to write this diagram without that member AD. This is 30 kilonewton. And have 40 here, and this is A, B, C, D. All other details like length and supports remain as it is. So you can call this as figure B, From this diagram, we can calculate the member forces required because of the applied loading. And you can give the notation as PS. To calculate the member forces, that means FAB and FDB or FAC like that, we make use of method of joints. Now, use method of joints to find the member forces in this particular truss. Look here, I have two supports here, therefore I am going to get the reactions here, one vertical reaction and one horizontal reaction, and here also one vertical reaction. You can mark this as RB and this as RA and this as HA. Now, before start analyzing the joints, we should find the unknown reactions here. To find the reactions, we should apply the equilibrium condition. So first, apply summation of MA equals to 0, clockwise moment as positive. You just search the joint where you have more number of forces, just to eliminate these unknown forces. At A, I have two unknown forces. Therefore, I take moment about A. As usual, clockwise moment as positive. I have RB and this distance is 3 meters. RB into 3 is acts in anti-clockwise direction. Therefore, minus RB into 3. And I won't get any moment because of HA, RA and this 30, because all these three forces passes through the point A. And I have one more force, that is 40 kilonewton. This 40 into perpendicular distance, again this vertical distance is 3 meters. Therefore, it is plus 40 into 3. It is acting in clockwise direction and this equals to 0. If you solve this particular equation, I am going to get the value of RB as 40 kilonewton. Now, one more equilibrium condition, that is summation of Fy equals to 0, upward forces as positive. So here I have Ra is acting in upward direction, Rb is acting in upward direction, then 30 is acting in downward direction, therefore minus. If you solve this particular equation, you are going to get the value of Ra as, I know Rb, substitute here, 40 minus 30, it is plus 10. If you send to right hand side, you get the value of Ra as minus 10. Look, I have marked the reactions like this. That means I have assumed initially the reactions are acting in upward directions. If I get the positive value, whatever the direction I have assumed initially is correct, or else I need to change the direction of this reaction. For RB, I have got plus 40, therefore this direction is correct. For RA, I have got minus 10. I need to change the direction of RA. So, I am just changing the direction to the downward side. Or else you can keep the direction as it is, but while substituting, you have to substitute the value of RA as minus 10. Now here, if you mark the values, this is 10 and RB value is plus 40 and I need to find HA. So to find HA, you need to apply summation of Fx equals to 0, right side forces as positive. If you look here, I have HA to the left side and plus 40 to the right side equals to 0. You won't find any other horizontal forces in this particular figure, therefore the reaction, horizontal reaction at A is plus 40. Therefore this is plus 40 kilonewton. Now I got all the reactions required in this particular structure. Now you can consider the joints to get the member forces. So you can select any of the joints. For example, you can select C, D, B, A like that. But while selecting the joint for analysis, we should see that at this particular joint, the number of known forces should be less than 2 or equal to 2. So this is the primary criteria that we use in method of joints. So now if you see such joints, see, look at A, I have 1, 2, 3, 4 members. Here 4 members are meeting. Among 4, I know these two values, RA and HA. But I don't know AB and AC. So I can select this joint. If you take B, again here we have 4 members. 1, 2, 3, 4. Among 4, I know only one force. three forces are unknown. Therefore, initially I can't select B joint for analysis. Clear? So, consider joint A and write the free body diagram of joint A. So, this is joint A. See, RA is acting in downward direction. So, the value is 10. And HA to the left side, and the value is 40. This is joint A. See, like this, you should write the free body diagram. Here, I know the value of HA and RA, but I don't know the values in these two members. So, you should assume initially these two members are acting away from the joint. This is a joint. I don't know the member forces. Therefore, I write it as FAB and this as FAC. And you just note it down. This is the sign convention you should remember in case of method of joints. If the forces are acting away from the joints, it is taken as tension, and tensile forces positive. If the forces are acting towards the joint, such forces are considered as compression, and compressive force is taken as negative. Please remember these two symbols. Now, initially, I don't know these two forces, therefore I have taken these two forces are acting away from the joint, that means in a positive sense. And to find these unknown forces, I take the help of equilibrium condition, that is summation of fx equals to 0. To the right side, all the forces are positive. So, observe this free body diagram and write down the forces which are acting horizontally. If they are acting towards right, take them in positive sense. If they are acting to the left side, take them as negative. So, here I have FAB to the right side, therefore positive, minus 40, because 40 is acting to the left side, equals to 0. Therefore, FAB equals to 40 kilonewton. And immediately, if you get the positive value within bracket, here itself, write it as tensile force. And I've got FAB. Now I need to find FAC. So to find FAC, I take one more equilibrium condition, that is summation of Fy equals to 0. And here I take upward forces as positive. Count only the vertical forces here. I have FAC and 10. Since FAC is acting in upward direction, I'll call it as plus FAC minus 10 equals to 0. Therefore, FAC equals to plus 10. Again, this is positive value, mark it as tensile force. Now, immediately analyzing one particular joint, whatever the member forces you have got, mark these values on this particular truss. For example, I've got FAB as 40, plus 40. Plus 40 means it is tension away from the joint. See, this is joint and this is joint, away from the joint. 40 kilonewton. And AC, again it is plus 10 and it is tension, that is away from the joint. This is also joint and this is also joint, away from the joint. This is plus 10. Immediately after analyzing the joint, particular joint, you should mark the values like this. Now you can select one more joint for analysis to find the remaining member forces. I need to find CD, DB and BC, three member forces. So you can select C now. Look at C. Again, there are four members here. Among four members, I know this 30 and this is 10. I don't know these two. So you can select C, or you can select D also. So if I select D, consider joint D and write the free body diagram of joint D. This is joint D. Mark the forces which are meeting at D. So if you know the force value, write that. So here I know 40 kilonewton. Then I don't know what is FDB and FDC. Therefore, this is D and I mark this as FDB and this as FDC. As usual, apply the equilibrium conditions. summation of fx equals to 0, horizontal force equilibrium condition, right side forces as positive, I have plus 40 minus fdc equals to 0, therefore fdc equals to plus 40 kilonewton. And to find this fdb, summation of fy equals to 0, upward forces as positive. So here I have only one vertical force, that too acting in downward direction. Therefore fdb minus fdb equals to 0. That gives me fdb equals to 0. So you can mark immediately the positive values as tensile forces. So just transfer those values on this particular diagram. Fdc is plus 40, that is away from the joint, and fdb is 0. Look at the structure. I have got member forces almost in all the members, AB, AC, DC and DB. I left with only BC. Either you can select joint C or joint B, so to get the member force. So I select joint B because I can take off this member, because here the member force is 0. Consider joint B. Write on the free body diagram of joint B. So this is joint B. So these are the forces I'm getting in joint B. See, this force is 0, and here I have RB as 40 kilonewton, and here horizontal force as 40 kilonewton, and this is the inclined member force, that is FBC. If you get inclined member force, you have to resolve such force into horizontal and vertical component. This is called FBC. The vertical is always accompanied by sine theta, and this is FBC cos theta, and theta is making an angle of 45 degree with respect to horizontal. So how I got 45 degree? So look here, this is 3 meters and this is 3 meters. I'm marking this as theta. So theta equals to tan inverse of 3 by 3. Tan inverse of 1 is nothing but 45 degrees. Now find this FBC. For that, either you can apply FX or FY. See, here the only unknown force is FBC. That is, only one unknown force I have. Therefore, either you have to apply FX equation or FY equation. I use FX equation. Right side horizontal forces as positive. So I have minus 40 and minus FBC cos theta equals to 0. So look at this free body diagram. I have this as horizontal force and this resolved horizontal force, and this should be equals to FBC equals to minus 40 divided by cos 45. So if you solve this, I'm going to get the value of FBC as minus 56.57 kilonewton. Since I've got the value in negative sense, you can mark this as compression. So towards the joint, 56.57 kilonewton. So if you observe figure B, I've got all the member forces by applying the concept of method of joints. So this completes step number 2. For further calculation, I need these values. That means you just remember this figure B. Now in step 3, we are going to compute the member forces because of the unit load applied along the member AD. You know, member AD is considered as redundant. That means that is the coordinate number 1. Since we have DSI 1 here, we get only one coordinate. So we should write the truss structure again. So this is the given truss. So we have the points A, B, this is C, this is D, and this is BC, the diagonal element. And along AD, along this member, we are going to apply the unit load. This is the coordinate number 1. And we should apply the unit load in positive sense, that is away from the joints. These are the joints. We are taking the force away from the joint. And we know we have the reactions RA, and this is HA, and this is RB. Here the horizontal distance is 3 meters and the vertical distance is also 3 meters. And I am removing all the externally applied loads here. That is, we have 30 and 40 here, I have removed them. And you should also observe that the reactions, whatever we are going to get here, that is RB, RA and HA, are different. That means we need to calculate these reactions if required because of the applied load 1 kN along the coordinate 1, that is along the redundant AD. Clear? So call this particular figure as figure C, and this figure gives me the details of member forces because of unit load at coordinate number 1, that is at AD. And you can call the forces available because of this particular loading case as K. So the member forces, whatever we have got because of the externally applied load, is called as PS, and the member forces, whatever we are going to get now because of the unit load applied along the redundant force, is called as K. Now again, we use the concepts of method of joints to get the member forces in this particular structure. See, in previous sessions, we were using unit load method and conjugate beam method to find the unknowns. So here, in case of trusses, to find the unknowns, we are just using the method of joints. First, look at all the joints and select the particular joint wisely where you have number of unknowns less than 2 or equal to 2. So if you look for that, see, if I take joint D, here I get 3 forces, 1, 2 and 3. Among 3, I know 1 force. The value of that force is 1 kN. Therefore, I need to find DC and DB. Therefore, initially you can select joint D and C also. But you can't select A or B. If you want to select joint A or B, you need to find these reactions. Unnecessarily, don't waste the time. Without finding these reactions, I can easily get the member forces here. Therefore, just take joint D and write the free body diagram of joint D. So if you write the free body diagram of joint D, it looks like this. This is D. So this value, I know it is 1 kN. This is FDC acting away from the joint. I've assumed all the unknown forces in a positive sense. This is FDB. And if you get the inclined member force, immediately resolve that force into horizontal and vertical components. As usual, mark the theta with respect to horizontal component, and horizontal component is accompanied by force into cos theta, and vertical component is accompanied by force into sine theta. And if you want to find theta, again it is tan inverse of, since the horizontal and vertical dimensions are same. See, this is the theta I am marked in this particular joint. So it is opposite by adjacent, it is tan inverse of 3 by 3, again I am going to get 45 degrees here. Clear? So now again apply the equilibrium conditions. I will apply summation of Fx equals to 0, that is horizontal forces equals to 0, and I consider right side forces as positive. So here I have FDC to the left hand side, therefore minus, then minus 1 cos theta, theta is 45. That equals to 0. So if you solve this particular equation, you are going to get the value of FDC as minus cos 45, and the value of cos 45 is 0.707 kN. And since I have got the negative value, you can mark it as compressive force. So apply one more equilibrium condition to get the one more member force here. So I use summation of Fy equals to 0, upward forces as positive. I have minus FDB then minus 1 sine theta, and theta is 45, that equals to 0. If you solve this, you are going to get FdB as minus sine 45. Sine 45 value is minus 0.707 kilonewton. Since I've got the negative value again, this is also called a, this is also a compressive type of force. So immediately mark these forces on the structure. So here I have FdC as compressive towards the joint, and FdB also as compressive towards the joint, and the values are same, 0.707 kilonewton. Now you can take one more joint. If you check B, here again we have four forces, RB, BA, BD and BC. Among four forces, I know only this particular value. Therefore, you can't take this B joint. And if you check with A, here also I don't know four forces here. First of all, there are five forces are meeting at this particular joint. Therefore, this is ruled out. The remaining joint is joint C. Therefore, you can consider the free body diagram of joint C. At joint C, if you observe, there are three forces. This is 0.707 kilonewton. And here I don't know the force, therefore you can consider FCA. And this also don't know, therefore you can consider as FCB. So again, I have got one inclined force here. Therefore, resolve it to horizontal and vertical component and mark this as theta. So this is FCB cos theta and this is FCB sine theta. So if you check the value of theta, so look here. So this is the theta I have marked there. So opposite by adjacent, again opposite is 3 meters and adjacent is 3 meters. Tan inverse of 3 by 3 is again, we are going to get the theta value as 45. So you can apply the conditions of equilibrium. Summation of fx equals to 0, right side as positive. Therefore, I get FCB cos 45, this force. And this 0.707 is acting towards left. Therefore, it is negative. That equals to 0. If you solve this particular equation, I'm going to get the value of FCB as plus 0.707 divided by cos 45. So cos 45 is nothing but 0.707. I'm going to get plus 1. Since I've got positive value, mark this force as tensile force. Now I need to calculate one more member force, that is FCA. For that, I make use of another equilibrium condition. Summation of Fy equals to 0, upward forces as positive. Since FCA is acting in downward direction, call it as minus FCA. Then one more force because of this inclined member, minus FCB sine 45 equals to 0. So the value of FCB we got just now, substitute that here as 1. So if you solve this, FCA equals to minus 707 kilonewton, and this is compressive nature of force. So immediately mark these values on the structure. So FCA is compressive force of intensity 0.707 kilonewton, and FCB is tensile force of intensity 1 kilonewton. Now I need to analyze one more joint to get the member force in AB. Either you can select A or you can select B. So if you want to select A, look here, I have again five forces here, HA, RA, AB, AD and AC. So among these five forces, only two forces are known, three forces are unknown. Therefore, I can't select A joint, the remaining joint is B. Therefore, by considering joint B, write down the free body diagram of that particular joint. So this is RB, I don't know, you have to worry about that. And this is 0.707 kilonewton. and the inclined component value is 1 kilonewton. And I don't know this, this is called as FBA. The unknown forces are always marked in positive sense, away from the joint. And again, I have inclined force here, just split that to horizontal and vertical component and call this as theta. If you mark this as theta, so it is 3 by 3, tan inverse of 3 by 3. Again, the value of theta remains 45. And this horizontal component is accompanied by cos and vertical by sine. So I just need this FBA and this is horizontal. Therefore, if you apply summation of fx equals to 0, clockwise as positive, it is minus FBA, then minus this horizontal component because of this 1 kilonewton. This is 1 cos theta. Theta is 45 equals to 0. These two are the only horizontal forces in this particular free body diagram. So if you solve this, the value of FBA is minus 0.707 kilonewton. And you can call this as compressive force. So immediately mark that force on the structure. So 0.707 kilonewton. So now I've got, look at the structure, I've got all the member forces required on this particular truss because of the unit load applied along AD. So this completes step number 3. Again, for further calculation, I need these values. So remember these values. So now in step number 4, we are going to use the flexibility matrix relationship, that is D minus DL equals to F into P. And since there is no sinking of supports, we can neglect this D, displacement because of sinking of supports or rotation of supports. And we left with the equation 2, that is minus DL equals to F into P. Since in this particular problem, we have got the DSI as 1, here the order of all these matrices will be 1 cross 1. Therefore, I get only one element in all these matrices. Therefore, to find DL, we make use of this particular formula, that is summation of PS into K into L divided by AE. And to find F, that is flexibility matrix, we use summation of K square L divided by AE. And you all know this is the force matrix. Initially, I have assumed the redundant force P as FAD. That is here FAD equals to P. And after getting this DL and F, if you substitute the respective values in equation 2, easily we can get this P, just like we were doing in analysis of frames and analysis of beams. And you know PS is the member forces because of the applied load in a given truss structure, and K is the member forces because of the unit load applied along the assumed redundant. Now to find this value, that is summation of PS into K into L and summation of K square into L, I need one standard table. Let us formulate that particular table. So here the table consists of member, the member forces in a structure because of the externally applied load, then K, that is member forces because of the unit load applied along the redundant, then length of all the members in meters. I need this product. So write that PS into K into L. Then I need this one K square into L. So write that also. So you can formulate this table easily. Already I have got all the values. We have used a method of joints to find the member forces because of externally applied load and because of the unit load. Use figure B and figure C now to fill up this table. So I have totally 6 members in the given truss. So mark the members now. I have AB, AC, BC, CD, BD and AD. So if you refer the truss given, you can mark the members easily. Now to fill up this column, that is the details regarding PS. So refer diagram B, that is figure B. So if you refer figure B, you are going to get the values of this column, that is forces because of the externally applied load. For member AB, it is 40, and all the forces are in kilonewton. I just write the numbers here. In AB, it is 40. In AC, it is 10. And in BC, it is minus 56.57. And in CD, it is 40. And in BD and AD, the forces are 0. If the forces are tensile, write them in positive sense. If it is compressive, write it in negative sense. Now, by referring figure C, write the details regarding K, that is member forces because of the unit load applied along the coordinate, that is the redundant AD. So if you look that particular diagram, you get the details, that is force in member AB will be, that is FAB, FAC, like that. The force in member FAB is, it is minus 0.707. At AC also it is minus 0.707, at BC it is plus 1, again at CD it is minus 0.707, along BD it is again minus 0.707, and along redundant it is 1 kilonewton. Now you can easily fill the length values, just refer figure A, the given truss structure, it is 3, 3, 3 and 3. For the diagonal elements, to calculate the length, you just apply the Pythagoras theorem. See, this is the given truss structure. So this is A, this is B, C, and this is D. And here I have reactions. And here I have some load like this. So this is given as 3 meters and this length is as 3 meters. If I want this inclined length, you can easily apply the Pythagoras theorem and you can find the length of diagonal element AC and BD. So the length of diagonal element is given as 4.24. So now it is just simple calculation. I have got the value of P, K and L for all the members. You just fill these details by multiplying these values. If you want the value of PS K into L for member AB, you have to do 40. Look here, I'll just do it here. You have to do 40 into minus 0.707 into 3. Like this, you have to do for all the members. And if you want K square into L, so for member AB, it is minus 0.707 whole square multiplied by the length 3 meters. Clear? Like that you can calculate all the values required here. So for the first member AB, it is minus 84.84. For AC, it is minus 21.21. For BC, it is minus 239.81. For CD, it is minus 84.84. For BD and AD, it is 0. And here, it is 1.5. This is also 1.5. 4.24. 1.5. 1.5. And 4.24. Now, look at the formula. I need the summation of this particular column. So, if you do the summation of PS, K into L, you are going to get the value as minus 430.7. And if you do the summation of this K square L, you are going to get the value as 14.48. Now substitute these values in equation 2. So if you do so, look at the equation 2, it is minus DL. Minus DL is equals to this formula. So I have got minus of minus 430.7 divided by AE. Here they have given AE as constant. If they give some values for AE, you need to substitute those values. And F value, it is 14.48 divided by AE multiplied by P, and this P is called as FAD. So if you solve this, AE and AE gets cancelled, this minus into minus, this will become plus, FAD equals to 430.7 divided by 14.48, and that gives me the value plus 29.74 kilonewton. So this is P, the force matrix. Since I have got only one DSI, I have only one unknown here. So if you get DSI value as 2, then you need to assume two redundants. If you want, you can assume these two diagonal elements as redundants or any other members in this particular truss as redundants. Not only members, even you can assume the reactions as redundants. But if you take off the diagonal elements, further procedure becomes simpler. Then here in this particular step, I get two elements D1L and D2L and two unknown forces P1 and P2, and I need to find four flexibility coefficients there, F11, F21, F12 and F22. That means I need to repeat the method of joint procedure one more time to find K2. Here, since I have got only one redundant, I need to apply the unit load only at one coordinate. If I get two coordinates, I get K1 and K2, like that. But the entire procedure remains as it is if you get more number of degree of static indeterminacy also. So step number 5 is the last step in this particular analysis, and here we are going to compute the final forces in the truss structure. So to find the final forces in all the members, we make use of this equation. Final forces is given by Pf, and this Pf equals to Ps plus K into P. You know, Ps is the force because of the externally applied load, and K is the member force because of the unit load applied at the redundant, and P is the redundant force. That is, here in this particular problem, the value of P is equals to FAD, that is force in the member AD. Now, to calculate the forces in all the members, again I need to formulate one standard table here, which comprises of member, this PS, which is given by kilonewton, then the K, and P is same for all the members, then PF, final forces. So again, you just mark the members. It is AB, AC, and this is BC, then CD, I have BD and AD. Now just fill up these details. We already got the values of PS, K and P for all the members. Clear? Like this, I have filled the details here. This is from figure B and this is from figure C. This value we just got now in step number 4, and this will be same for all the members, 29.74, and by using the equation 3 you can calculate this PF. For one member I'll just show here, PFAB equals to the value of PS for member AB is 40, and the K value is minus 0.707, and the value of P is 29.74. If you solve this particular equation, you are going to get the value of FAB as, this is positive 18.97 kilonewton. So you can just transfer this value onto this table, 18.97. Like this, you can calculate the forces, final forces in all the members. Just by using this equation 3, we have filled all these values. And if you want, you can add this particular column in the table 1 itself. But just to avoid the confusion, I have just segregated the tables. Clear? So now you can also mark the nature of force here. That is whether we have got compressive force or tensile force like that. If you got the positive values, then the forces are tensile in nature. If you got the negative value, the forces are in compressive nature. Like this, you can mark the nature of forces also. So now, take the final diagram of the truss with all the reactions and externally applied loading. This is 30, this is 40, and we have two diagonal elements here. This is A, this is B, and this is C, this is D, and the reaction, this is 10 kilonewton, this is 40 kilonewton, this is also 40 kilonewton. So now you can call this as figure D, which shows the final forces PF in all the members. So just by looking into this particular table, mark the values here. So along AB, it is tension away from the joints. Along AC, it is compression towards the joint. And along BC, it is compression, therefore towards the joint. Then along CD, it is tension away from the joint. And along BD, again, it is compression, that is towards the joint. And along AD, it is tension away from the joint. Just for clarification, I've used different colors here. For tensile, I've used yellow color, and for compressive forces, I've used orange color. Just mark the forces. This is 18.97. All the forces are in kilonewton. Then AC, this is 11. Then BC, this is 26.82. Then CD, this is 18.97. Then BD, 21.02. And AD, it is 29.74. So this completes the analysis of trusses by using flexibility matrix approach. If you recall the steps, in step number one, we are going to find the degree of static indeterminacy. Based on that number, we are going to assume the number of redundants. You can assume either reactions or diagonal elements or other members in the truss structure as redundants. And in step number two, we are going to compute the forces required in the members of truss given by removing the redundants assumed. There we keep only the applied loads. So that is called as PS, and we calculate this PS in all the members by using method of joints. And in step three, we repeat the same procedure, but there we are going to remove the externally applied loads and we apply the unit load along the redundancies assumed. And that gives me the values of K, that is member forces required in the truss structure because of the unit load applied at different coordinates. And in step number four, we make use of flexibility matrix equation, that is D minus DL equals to F into P. And you know, if you don't have sinking of supports, we can neglect the matrix D. So to find DL and F matrices, we have the formula here, that is summation of PS KL divided by AE for DL matrix and summation of K square into L divided by AE for F matrix. So to find these summations, we need to formulate one standard table. After formulating the standard table, if you substitute the respective values in flexibility matrix equation, we are going to get the P matrix. At the final step, that is step number five, we are going to compute the final forces required in the truss structure. For that, we make use of this equation, that is PF equals to PS plus KP. To find this PF, again, we are going to formulate this standard table. After finding the final forces in all the members, you just mark the nature of force, whether it is tensile or compressive, based on the positive or negative values. Then the same forces will be transferred onto the truss structure given. So with these five steps, we can analyze any truss by using flexibility matrix method. Let us meet in the next session. Thank you.